Welcome to the Buffalo Review TV. I'm Edwin J. Vieira.
And I'm Jacob Fyke. We will discuss topics such as free tuition in New York State, the Buffalo State women's lacrosse team taking on SUNYAC rival Brockport, back ready bike share to Buffalo, and much more. Stay tuned.
Now, from the campus of SUNY Buffalo State, news and information for Buffalo and the surrounding communities, it's the Buffalo Review TV, produced by Stripes Media.
USG and the Visual Arts Board will be having Paint Night on Monday, April 24th at 7 p.m. This event will be held in Assembly Halls 1 and 2, which are on the third floor of the Campbell Student Union Building. Students will have the opportunity to paint and enjoy a night of relaxation while unwinding with other students here on campus. Students will also be able to paint a spring-inspired image, which will be chosen and orchestrated by instructor Monica Ramos.
The Buffalo State Philharmonia will present their final performance of this 2016-2017 school year on Tuesday, May 2nd at the Performing Arts Center in Rockwell Hall. The time of the event is at 7:30 p.m. Their performance will be about symphonic masterworks, a celebration of women in music, along with a joint performance with the college's choir and chorale. The Philharmonia will perform under the direction of Daniel Basin, who is a composer, trumpeter, and conductor, while the choirs will be performed by Dr. Victoria Furby and John Flasham. Tickets are free to Buffalo State students and are $10 to the general public. You can pick up your tickets at the Rockwell Hall box office.
Buffalo State will be hosting the event Write On, which will be a gathering of writers. Those who enjoy the art of writing are encouraged to join the event. Write On will be held on April 21st from 10 a.m. to noon in room 181B of the Butler Library. The event is open for both students and staff, and refreshments will be available. New York State just recently passed the tuition-free degree program, which will allow some students who meet certain criteria will get free tuition for the next two up-and-coming semesters. This is the first program of its kind in our country, and here's Osmond Shire with more on the story.
Many rejoice after Governor Cuomo has officially announced that his free college tuition initiative will be enacted the start of 2017 under the name Excelsior Scholarship.
And no one is going to be deprived of college because they cannot afford it.
Under this approved proposal, parents making $100,000 or less a year will allow students to be qualified for $7,000 a year in an accredited four-year institution. Every year after will add $25,000 to the $100,000 cap limit.
Excelsior Scholarship will cover anything that TAP and the Pell Grant doesn't cover.
Provisions are set where you have to be a full-time student attending a publicly funded institution and maintain a certain GPA requirement.
Then you have to take time off and your GPA drops. That could really hurt you, not only through your education, but now it's going to hurt you financially because you weren't really prepared to pay for this loan back.
I sat down with Buffalo State's Provost Perot to hear her thoughts on how this will not only impact students, but Buffalo State's own initiative, Roar for Four.
Actually, completing 15 credits a semester is the way, it's just basic math, to get to the undergraduate degree in 4 years.
Cuomo's initiative is approved for two semesters this upcoming fall 2017.
I'm Osmond Shire, and this is the Buffalo Review TV.
The Buffalo State women's lacrosse team took on SUNY Brockport this past Saturday at Coyer Field and fell to the Golden Eagles by a score of 18-9. Junior attacker Alana Hearn led the team with 4 goals and 2 assists, while junior attacker Christina Crowell had and 4 others each chipped in a goal. Hearn and sophomore attacker Morgan Hold led the team with 2 assists. The Bengals are now 6-7 on the season and are 3-2 in the SUNYAC Conference. Their next game will be home Saturday, April 22nd, as the Bengals will take on the Oneonta Red Dragons at 1 p.m.
The Anthropology Society Club is hosting Cultural Night Japan on Tuesday, April 18th during Bengal Pause in the classroom building, room B118. The event is to promote different cultures, demonstrations, and food from Japan. You can RSVP for this event on Bengal Connect.
The West African Drumming Ensemble will be performing on April 20th. They will be performing at the Luis P. Simonelli Recital Hall, which is located on the third floor of Rockwell Hall at Buffalo State. Admission is free for students and $10 for general admission. Doors open at 7 p.m. and performance starts at 7:30 p.m. Tickets can be purchased online. The Buffalo Annual Moore Block Party is happening once again, a competition between three different sections of dance, step, and Greek. The reigning champions, the Brothers of Iota Phi Theta, will be returning for a fifth win. Moore Block Party will be happening on Friday, April 28th this year, and the block party will be in Tower 4 parking lot this year.
Buffalo State's Zaria Anderson will be having a fashion show at the Rockwell Hall Pathway. Anderson's newly recognized organization, Zen Model Boot Camp, will be hosting and participating in the event. Zen Lights Fashion Show will be Sunday, April 30th, 2017. The Ready Bike Share program is finally making its return here to Buffalo. Here's Eli Fortune with more on the story.
Launching on July 21st of 2016, Ready Bike Share has returned for its second season to the city of Buffalo.
Being that Ready Bikes is new to Buffalo, we were really curious to see how many people would ride. In regards to members, we had 1,700 people get on a bike last year, which actually did surpass our goal of 1,000. What's really exciting about this year is we actually have a full season of opportunities to get people on bikes. Last year we started in late July. This year we're starting in April. So what's even more exciting is that we will be open during National Bike Month, which is May, and we'll be working with Go Bike Buffalo and Visit Buffalo Niagara in order to promote people getting on bikes and just traveling the city, exploring all the great things there are to do in Buffalo and all the events and festivals. We're really excited. So first of all, you sign up online at readybikeshare.com and choose your membership pass. You could do a monthly pass, you could have an annual pass, or you could actually sign up as a group for up to four people. Once you have your account number, you choose a PIN, and then it takes about 3 minutes to get signed up, and as soon as you're signed up, you walk up to the bike's back panel, type in your account number and your PIN, the bike unlocks, you place it in the holster, make sure you adjust your seat properly to your height, and then you can get on and then ride anywhere you want to go.
Ready Bikes, I feel as though they're this great, fun way that they allow campus students to get around the Buffalo area, explore the park with a group of friends. And this is a great way to bond and have fun.
We are going to take a short break here at the Buffalo Review. Stay tuned for our interview segments featuring Monique Maxwell and Terrence Young.
3, 2, 1, cue on, take camera 2.
You're watching the Buffalo Review TV, produced by Stripes Media. You can find out more about our show at our website, thebuffalorevue.wordpress.com, and we welcome your feedback. If you have a question, comment, or story idea, you can email us at thebuffaloreview@gmail.com.
Hi, everyone. My name is Monique Maxwell, and I'm here with Trisha Herrick from the International Education Department. Today, we'll be talking about a summer exchange program coming to Buffalo State, as well as some study abroad opportunities. Thank you for coming in today. So can you tell me a little bit about yourself and your department?
I feel like I have the best job at Buffalo State College. I feel like a genie that grants wishes for people to study abroad or study away, so it's a really great gig. I've just been here over a year, and I'm looking forward to meeting more students and granting their wishes.
Awesome. So what is this exchange program, the China exchange program that I've been hearing about?
I'm a little excited about it, so I'll try to contain my excitement. But basically, we have a lot of students that come and study here from China. And Zhejiang University decided that they wanted to host us. So this summer, they are hosting us on a trip for many of their partnerships. So it's students that are selected from all of their partners around the world, and it's 20 lucky winners. For Buffalo State, we can have two or three. And we're just doing an essay to see who can do it. The catch is that it's got to be students that can study in the summer, and they have to pay for their airfare, a visa, and health insurance. So we're calculating that cost around $1,500 when they fly in there to the middle of China, they'll be able to do a lot of cultural immersions, meet people from different countries, be wined and dined. Well, maybe not the wine, but they'll be able to taste food and try experiences. And they're going to end the trip by climbing a mountain and flying out of Shanghai. Doesn't that sound exciting?
Awesome. That's awesome. So what are the eligibility requirements? Or is it just the essay that they write?
That you're in good standing at Buffalo State, no judicial, and that you write an essay.
Awesome. And how is this exchange program different from study abroad that we have here on campus?
Good question. This is a really unique opportunity that's more of like a travel tourist trip that any of us would take, you know, with our families. The difference for this one is there's no credit associated. So most study abroad and study away experiences at Buffalo State have credits associated with them, and this one just doesn't. So you're paying out of pocket for that flight and that visa and that health insurance, where a lot of times you can use your financial aid to pay for the credit-bearing trips.
Gotcha. So how can students that don't receive financial aid, how do they go about covering a study abroad trip?
I feel very fortunate that we're in an era with social media. I think we know the impact that it makes on our lives. I think it's a great tool. I have to tell you about a student. His name's Sam, we'll call him. And Sam really wanted to study abroad, and his program deposit was coming up. So what Sam did is he posted on Facebook with his PayPal account, and within 2 days he had the $500 deposit he needed for his particular trip to go on. So I think there's a lot of ways that you can just let your friends know, family know, write letters. We had one student, she had a baby shower in her family, put a little cup for donations there next to the presents, and her family helped sponsor her for her trip. And there's lots of different scholarships as well. So you don't necessarily have to have financial aid. Buffalo State's very generous with their scholarships. And everything that you get while you're a student here, you get to continue to have while you're studying abroad or away. So if you currently are an EOP student, you get to keep that. If you're an honor student, you get to keep that scholarship too. So that, I think, is really cool.
That is awesome. That's awesome. So more about the China program. Mm-hmm. So for students that are leaving from China to Buffalo, are there any requirements or accommodations that are made for them? Do they have to know how to speak the language or
good
anything
question.
Like that?
Everyone going is going to speak English. Of course, if you know a little bit of Mandarin, it would sure help. But it's not required. They'll be doing English for the whole trip. And it'll be just a unique opportunity to fly whatever, from the moment you board the plane, if you do Air China, to learn different language and different customs. So it'll be a great immersion trip, and it's not required to have to know Chinese.
Nice. And how safe is this program?
Because you're going to be housed on campus, you're going to be escorted from the moment you land all the way till when you leave. I would say it's very safe. Since I mentioned about mountain climbing, there might be some people that have some medical conditions that maybe that wouldn't be the best choice for them. So that's something to consider. But other than that, I think it's very safe. You can get a lot of cell service in China, so you can phone back home if you need to. And we do buy health insurance coverage for all our students that even included flying them back home if they need to be.
Awesome. And so you said the students, they're staying on campus. Are there any opportunities where students are staying with other families? Or I have a family member who she had students staying like in her home that lived with her, but they were like studying. So do you have any opportunities like that here at Buffalo State?
We do. Buffalo State has the oldest study abroad program in all of the SUNY system. It's the Siena, Italy program that started in 1961. And it's designed so you live with a host mama, I say. Most of them are older couples or older women. And the unique thing is they're really generous and give back and have you join a part of the family. And also they don't have Social Security like we do here in the U.S. So this is a really good component to help supplement their income. So it's a win-win for both. And so that's a great opportunity. Our Salamanca program is the second oldest. It's 40 years old, and it is allowing students to live in host families so they can really immerse in the language.
That is awesome. That's really awesome. So where do you see the program in a few years?
Right now, since I've been at Buffalo State, we've had 233 students study away, whether the National Student Exchange or study abroad. I would like to double that number in the next couple of years. We are trying to do really affordable trips. We did spring break trips this year that were only a couple thousand dollars that were credit bearing. And then we've had other trips, you know, that they're gone the whole semester or the academic year. So I'd just like to see more opportunities that fits everyone's economic level.
Nice. What feedback have you gotten from students that have participated in the program?
Most of them have said it's life-changing. Sometimes students don't really know what they want to do when they grow up or what they want to do to make income. So it's a really good time to do a lot of self-reflection. A lot of cultures are a little bit slower paced than ours, maybe not China, but some of the places that they go, and it just really gives them time to reflect what they want to do. And they come back very energized and help me recruit other students. They've also started a travelers club at the beginning of this academic year. About November it started. It's not funded right now, but it's an opportunity for students that are interested in traveling or have already traveled to come back, and they get to talk about different things, meet students that come in and visit from other places. So that's a great opportunity.
Nice. And have you ever gotten any feedback that you might not have, maybe like a not so great experience, or students that, what are those reasons that students come back and maybe didn't enjoy their experience?
I think it's all in what you make of things. I choose every morning to choose joy and to be happy and stay positive in my role. Everyone else has, you know, we're all wired differently. So I think some people, if they're going and expecting the same Buffalo State experience that they have, it's not going to be the same. There might not be, you know, an RA on the floor that's available when you're locked out.
Right.
you know, you might have to do your own cooking, and there's not the student union where you can go and get food
so
many hours of the day. Yeah, it's very independent. I've also seen that some of the programs are very rigorous, and so I try to really educate the students or inform them what I know about the program, so there's not any... I don't want to be a used car salesman. I want them to know what they're getting, get the model they want, get the place they want to go, and what really makes sense, because we're just so different, and I want to make sure that people get what fits them.
Great, great. And one last question for you. Where can people go to find more information?
I am in South Wing, the fourth floor, and I'd be happy to have people anytime.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Trisha. This is the Buffalo Review. We're going to take a short break. And we'll be back with Terrence Young and his guest, Jackie Fliss, talking about therapy dogs here on campus.
3, 2, 1, cue on, take camera 2.
You're watching the Buffalo Review TV, produced by Stripes Media. You can find out more about our show at our website, thebuffalorevue.wordpress.com, and we welcome your feedback. If you have a question, comment, or story idea, you can email us at thebuffaloreview@gmail.com.
Welcome back to the Buffalo Review TV. I'm Terrence Young. This past Wednesday, Horizon Healthplex held a dog therapy workshop here at Buffalo State campus. Here to talk more about us, more about the event, is Jackie Fliss. So thank you for joining us, Jackie.
Thank you.
Please tell us more about what exactly happened at this event yesterday.
Okay, yes. We had, her name is Colleen. She's from Horizon Health Services, and she came in to talk about the differences between therapy dogs, service animals, and emotional support animals. And she actually founded the pet therapy at Horizon Health Services, and she actually breeds golden retrievers. And she actually brought in her youngest dog. Her name is Horizon. She's going to be about 2 next month. And she goes through the difference, like I said before, of the different types of animals, what kind of benefits and perks, all the bells and whistles that each animal has. And then she also talks about, too, how the pet therapy can help at the Horizon Health Service.
So I know having a pet, me, myself, had one, you know, it changes the household's pretty much perspective. Tell us, like, what exactly what each dog can do for each person's situation.
Sure. Pet therapy animal, it can be any dog. It doesn't have to be a golden retriever. The dog just has to be, playful and happy, not mean. And they have to become certified. And this Colleen, she actually does. There's certain organizations that can certify a dog to become a therapy dog. And then once they become certified, the dog and the owner, they're protected under health insurance. So they could come to places such as Buffalo State. And all they have to do is 6 hours. And therapy dogs is just for anyone who's feeling stressed out. Studies have shown that before you going into an exam, if you kind of play with the dog, pet the therapy dog, their test scores are actually higher. And she sometimes will also bring her dog in to elementary school age kids, those who have learning disabilities, dyslexia. So they'll read to the dog because the dog is non-judgmental and they're super confident. And the emotional support dog, it's very interesting, actually. You have to get a letter from it has to be a mental health doctor saying that this animal brings you comfort, whether you suffer from depression, anxiety, bipolar, schizophrenia, and they cannot discriminate against you. And the service dog, I'm sure many have seen throughout the Buffalo State campus.
Guide dogs. Yeah.
Guide dogs, for the blind, things like that. If someone's autistic, it takes a rigorous training for those service animals because they are trained to guide this person to day-to-day activities. Sometimes they may get something in the fridge for them, help them with the laundry, help them make phone calls. And they are also protected under laws as well.
So I know there's different type of breeds. One breed is better than the other. Does a certain breed, is that more required, like a golden retriever, stuff like that, or can like a Rottweiler become a service dog?
Yeah, any dog can be a service animal, therapy animal. Usually golden retrievers and greyhounds, I believe, are the most popular dogs. Colleen, in her presentation, she talks about how some vets, they will adopt dogs. And there was one that was actually a pit bull. You think pit bulls, sometimes they may be aggressive. But just that bond between them, and he is a war vet, so he's a kind of a service animal, kind of help him go places and just kind of stay by him side. So it doesn't discriminate against any dog, but usually like golden retrievers are the most common.
So during Colleen's presentation, did she mention anything about how to become a trainer? Because guide dogs, stuff like that, are becoming a lot more popular and more common. And there are a lot of people on campus I know that likes to get into that type of field. So how would they like to get into to a therapy dog field?
If anyone has a dog that they want to have a therapy dog, they can actually go down to the Weigel Health Promotions. We are located in the basement of Porter Hall. I know Porter Hall is also a residence hall. So to get into the basement, our door is facing Chase Hall. And you could go down to the basement, you could either speak with me or Paula, she is my supervisor, and we can give you Colleen's contact information, and you can give her a call, send her an email, and just say, just let her know that you have a dog and you're interested in, having them become a therapy dog. And it only takes about an hour, and she's just looking for making sure that the dog is not aggressive in any way, is well-behaved. And then you will have to do 6 hours every year to keep your status. So you definitely can come visit us down in Porter Hall.
So how long have you been in this field, and how has it affected your life personally?
Okay, during my undergraduate career, I became heavily involved in health promotions. I was going for my health science degree. So I really loved educating students about health and their topic, different topics. So when I came here for my graduate degree, I still had that passion for health promotions, and it's very different, but I still enjoy it. Students still always have questions, and any way I can assist them in making healthier decisions is what I love to do.
So back to the workshop that was held yesterday. How many people showed up to the event? I'm curious. I didn't get to make it myself.
We had about 5 or 6 students. The workshops tend to fluctuate. She actually came last week, did the same workshop, and we had about 20 students show up, and all different majors. We had some from my program, which is the higher education program. We have psychology, social work, health and wellness, because Colleen says that pet therapy is becoming so popular in many different fields. So a lot of the professors tend to encourage students to come and learn about the different types of service animals.
So how often do these workshops take place on campus?
The therapy dog workshop, yesterday was actually our last one, but we usually have about 2 every semester.
And how long has that been at Buff State?
I would probably say the past 3 or 4 years. Colleen has come. She does the therapy dog workshop, and then she also does the Narcan workshops as well.
So over the years that you've been involved in it, have you noticed a sort of more interest in terms of dog therapy, this type of health? And how do you think it's going to improve over the course of the next couple of years?
Yeah, I think, like I said before, I think there's been an increase of interest with the dog therapy because it's not just a health concern anymore. Many therapy dogs are now going into hospitals. Social workers sometimes may have their dog certified to be a therapy dog. So, a social worker may visit their clients and they'll bring their dog. So I think, many more majors are seeing or talking about pet therapy. So I could definitely see it increasing. And then I think it's super important too, because in Colleen's presentation, she talks about, the first thing, when she walked in with the dog, everyone, just had this huge smile on their face. That's what she, also talks about is how, by bringing a therapy dog, it can break down barriers. Maybe people aren't talking, and it'll start the conversation of people talking and building relationships. So I think that's where I see it going.
Okay, Jackie, well, that's all the time we have for this edition of the Buffalo Review. Tune back next week for another edition. Thank you.
The Buffalo Review TV, produced by Stripes Media, we welcome your feedback. If you have a question, comment, or story idea, you can email us at thebuffaloreview@gmail.com.